All right. Welcome everyone to first of Remote Year Legends of the World speaker series. My name is Hilary Rand. I was the city manager for in London for Remote Year this summer. So a big hi to Darian Batuta and Cousteau that I had the pleasure of hosting in London over the summer. And a special warm welcome to Dave, who I know will be joining us back on Remote Year craziness soon. Before we get started, I would just like to go through a couple of housekeeping items for the session. Please keep your screens muted at all times, just to make sure that there's no interference with the audio. We will dedicate half of this hour session today to live Q&A. I want to have it as interactive as possible, so please do send in your questions, but don't use the chat because that will be visible to all and it will be quite distractive running on the background. So if you can just use the Q&A function at the bottom of the screen, that would be much preferred. So just, you know, keep typing them as we go along. If you're at one of the viewing parties, just, you know, ask the host to use the computer to do that. That would be great, and I'll just, you know, keep the questions coming as they come in. So on to tonight's event. We have viewing parties set up currently in Split, Belgrade, Sofia, and Rabat, plus many more joining us from other locations around the world. We have one group in Kuala Lumpur, and we'll be sending them a video of tonight's session. It is my absolute pleasure to welcome you from my home country of Estonia. We are here in Tallinn tonight, and our guest speaker and one of the first Legend of the World speaker series is Sten Tamkivi. He is a fellow Estonian, also the CEO and co-founder of Teleport. Sten has had an extensive and incredibly impressive career in technology here in Estonia, in the Silicon Valley, and in many other very renowned places around the world. I could probably speak about an hour about all his accomplishments, but I'd rather have him introduce himself. So without further ado, Sten, if you would like to give us a bit of your background.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much, Hilary. And it's an absolute pleasure to see what Remote Year has become in this sort of short period of time that I've occasionally run to your founders or participants before. As far as my background, welcome to the Skype office here in Tallinn, Estonia. Estonia is where I'm originally from. And I've been a software entrepreneur since I was 18. So I've been building companies, mostly in this corner of the world, Northern Europe. And the biggest sort of startup story that I had the luxury and pleasure of joining was Skype, where I became an early executive in 2005. So the company was about 18 months old, and I stayed there for 7 years and helped it to grow to a point where it was acquired by Microsoft. So that's the biggest joyride I've had pre-Teleport in the tech world. And I guess what's relevant here to this audience is that I've lived in four countries, in Tallinn, London, Singapore, and I've spent about 10% of my life in California, in Silicon Valley, where I've done my master's at Stanford, then stayed behind, and I became an entrepreneur in residence at Andreessen Horowitz, which is a VC firm on Sand Hill Road. And that's where I started Teleport. And Teleport builds software for people to figure out where they should live and work. And it kind of builds on these life experiences that I've had myself, moving myself and family around. As many of you, if not all of you, have noticed, there are some unnecessary frictions involved when you go from country to country or continent to continent. And we believe that quite a few of those can be remedied with good software and delightful interfaces that help people to do those things better. And Teleport has been around for 2.5 years now. We're a team of 12 people, depending on the day, in 4 or 5 countries. We don't really care where people are. Most of our people are based somewhere, but two of our team members are like full nomads as well. So they switch locations quite frequently. So I just was surprised to see one walk into the Tallinn office today. I didn't know he's coming.
Well, that's great. Thank you for that. And kind of going more into what really kind of drove the creation of Teleport and how it was received at the beginning, the idea itself, and who did you get to co-found it with you, and kind of what was the initial process that started it all and making it what it is now?
When we started thinking about it, I think a few things happened. Like somewhere in the beginning of this process, I had this one bullet point on my list of ideas. What should I get working on after Skype? And on that idea list, there was this one thing which I called human mobility is broken. And those four words basically were the start of many conversations. And one of those conversations led to a guy called Balaji Srinivasan, who's a Stanford lifer and was a partner at Andreessen Horowitz at the time, and now is the CEO of 21, which is one of the best funded Bitcoin companies in the world. And Balaji, when I was contemplating and looking back at the experiences that we had at Skype, that the fact that by the time we had 200 people at Skype, we already had 10 locations, which kind of seems normal now, but in 2004 or 2005, it was quite abnormal, and it came from the fact that Skype, we were building this piece of software that allowed us to work irregardless of the location. So we kind of started doing that and took it as normal. And all of a sudden, I was sitting there, and every single week I had to deal with, okay, should we hire this person in City X or City Y, and should we move them to this other location, or should we open up an office there, and should we build this product in London or Stockholm, and all these questions. And so I came from this tactical, very, very personal pains that I had felt when making those location decisions. And Balaji, at the same time, was writing this piece for Wired magazine, which is something you should look up if you haven't ever read it. It's called "Software is Reorganizing the World," where he was having a play on Mark Andreessen's famous essay about software eating the world. And Balaji's claim was that there is this bigger trend where people, like-minded people, get together online to talk to each other, do things like we do right now, or build things together. Like they can have hundreds of people working on the same GitHub repository and shipping actual product without ever meeting. And Balaji's claim is that as a result of that, eventually will be that this affinity groups will start congregating in physical space. So the sort of virtual online communities will actually end up going to places. And this is already happening. I don't know, a bunch of startup teams joining Y Combinator will move to Silicon Valley for 3 months, but not necessarily all of them forever. And so he was looking at that phenomenon and thinking about that long-term future. And then we started chatting about it and came to a conclusion that, oh shit, that if we solved the practical issues I've seen already happening, then we're kind of creating the world that Balaji was envisioning. And sort of that became sort of the nascent idea behind Teleport, or the trigger behind Teleport. And Balaji is still, we proudly call him a co-founder. And then we figured out that we want to solve the discovery and search problem first. Like, there are many problems around mobility that you can go after. But when we identified that, then I turned to an old friend of mine from Skype called Silver Keskula, who's our first co-founder. And Silver was the guy who wrote he was the first researcher in the core team at Skype. And so he wrote the algorithms that help route the calls between 300 million computers around the world. So location optimization, or optimization in a large number of nodes, is some kind of his thing. And also he's one of our resident nomads as well. So he's lived in, I think, 9 or 10 countries now and studied on 4 continents and whatnot. So I think he's quite happy to be building something that helps him with that lifestyle as well.
And could you tell a little bit more about the product itself and the different applications? There's Teleport Flock, there's Sundial, and all of these, and what it kind of is really about, and how we already as a community can use it.
Mm-hmm. So when you build a company vision first, then it takes a lot of experimentation to figure out what the actual things are that users need and you can solve in a way that actually delights people. So there are other startups that are born with this narrow specific idea that let's fix this one thing and then iterate and build things around it. We came from sort of a broader view in and have been experimenting to find what the biggest short-term pain points are. And as a result of that, as you noticed, we have a portfolio of products. Most of them very small, very single application-minded apps. So our core product that is front and center of everything is something we call Teleport Cities. And that's where majority of our users come to. And they sign up and they onboard and they tell us a little bit about their preferences and requirements and their sort of financial situation and these things. And we take those preference sets and then look at all the data about income, cost, and quality of life data that we have gathered about the planet. And we currently cover about 250 cities with close to 300 dimensions of data. And so we basically jump through all that data and then show you all the cities in the world through your lens. Like, this is what your life would look like in Berlin, and this is what would happen if you moved to Amsterdam, and this is why Sao Paulo would have the best match to whatever preference to samba you might have, if you're into certain kinds of foods, maybe Japan would rank higher, and if it's comedy clubs, it's this other place. So basically, it's kind of a search engine, but it's not like a Google-like search where you enter a query and you get one this definite answer, but it's more of an explorative process of figuring out where would you fit, what would be the best place for you and your particular needs. So that's the center. And then there's a number of apps we built around that, like building on top of the same data sets. We've experimented with what are the other location-related things we could be solving. And the kind of thinking there is that instead of bloating the core product, like, what if we build the small useful things that people can use independently that don't become feature bloat in Teleport Cities? And so Teleport Flock is an example of that. It's a tool where we can, knowing where your people are, we can calculate where you should meet. So what's the cost and commute optimal place? If you have like all the locations that you already listed there where people are listening today, like if you enter this headcounts of people in those locations, we will calculate where the flight routes are, how much the tickets will cost, what's the availability of Airbnbs with appropriate sizes to fit everyone, and so forth. Then another example for this sort of group-related experiments is Teleport Sundial, which is something that we built for our own team, but if any of the remote gear groups would like to use that would be fantastic. Basically, we allow people to form groups, and they, when they update the location in Teleport apps, like the mobile app or the web app, then they can see each other's location on a map, and that helps that when people are on the move, then you actually know, okay, did my colleague already fly to Canada or not? Like answering questions like that. And we show also a time zone view. Like you can very quickly move a slider and show that, hey, if we do this call at 9 p.m. in Tallinn, like right now, what's it going to be in Kuala Lumpur? And will it be still feasible in the U.S.? Like simple things like that. And we have teams, like famous remote teams like GitLab, for example, is using that on their public about page. Like they show where their distributed team is, and we allow sort of exporting maps to third-party websites. And then we built stuff like Teleport Runway, which is a tool for startups to calculate that what if they moved their entire team to another city or hired it in another location, what would be the cost difference? That came from a bunch of founders pondering that in Silicon Valley, like where they can reduce their burn and increase their time left to build, and very often location change is the answer there. And Teleport 8-Ball is an app we built for salary comparisons. Like if you're a software developer in Munich and you're contemplating Barcelona, then we can show you what the salary difference will be, and so forth and so forth. So go to teleport.org and find the products page.
And you know, I just gave this example right now. If you want to move cities, where do you get all this data from? Where do you source all of this information? Because a lot of that is lifestyle information, and it's quite it's not about statistics really. It's much more about soft information, I guess.
The beauty of big data and the age we live in is that everything is about statistics. We've found, like you wouldn't believe, we've found some very, very qualitative sounding things that we can apply data collection mechanisms to and find some, if not data about the phenomenon, we can find close enough proxies that tell us something. So we have spent quite a lot of our investments since starting into building a very like sophisticated data pipeline. So what we do for our 300 data layers, we go and index probably, I would guess, between 60 and 80 data sources. And they could be open APIs somewhere. They could be static data dumps from some research. They could be public company or public APIs, and they could be private company APIs. So we're working with companies like Airbnb to look at their inventory and sort of understand what the market trends are. Then there are places where we just have to do what Google does and go and index the web, like find these bits and pieces and go through the noise. Then there's some stuff that where we have to intervene manually, like mostly when it comes to regulatory and immigration and taxes, and there's always something that is very customized and somebody needs to actually read some web pages and edit some things. And the most interesting and growing part of the data sets is what users contribute. Like a big part of, like, because users enter their salary and housing costs in order to make the right calculations on our site. So we are very careful with the privacy of our users. But when enough people have answered questions, like enough software developers in New York have told us their salaries, then we can start aggregate that data up, and without sacrificing user privacy needs, then we can start making deductions or deduct like what the salary market trends are there. Are they going up or down, or what's happening? And that's an ever-going work. Like this summer alone, I think we've added like 100 cities probably and probably 100 data dimensions. So it's a constant sort of evolving process. And about the qualitative things, I think two examples. One of them is that if you are looking for particular people who are interested in particular things, then you can look at the supply and demand. If you want to learn understand about demand, you can look at the supply as well. So if you want to understand how many people really like wine, you can look at the density in wine stores in the city. It's kind of like that sort of things. So sometimes you find some adjacency that is measurable that you can then bring in and say that, hey, this is a more wine-loving city than the other one. Or the other thing is what we realized is just distance. Like basically you can make a claim that you can snowboard in any city in the world. But the difference is like how much in time and money will it cost you to get to the mountain? So you can build a quantified data layer that shows you that, I don't know, one of the Arabic big multinational towns, I think in Dubai probably has like an indoor snowboarding slope, but maybe some other desert city has, you just have to fly several hours to get to the closest one, and that makes it expensive and so forth. And then we can rank that city lower for snowboarders. Whereas, I don't know, Innsbruck will rank much higher because it's all close. So some of those things, once you think about it a little bit, you can quantify it.
Great. I already had some questions come in, and people, you know, everyone, feel free to just type them in and send them my way. And talking about your users, how many users do you currently have? What's your user base, and what are the profiles, and how do you reach them, actually?
We have now the users that we have about 200,000 accounts now. And out of the accounts, and that has, we've had a fantastic year for user growth. Like we started January with 35,000 accounts, and the web-based search went out last August, so it's a little over a year. And we've had the mobile apps out since last April or something. So it's been a really nice start for user acquisition. And then out of those users, the other thing we measure is how many of them actually profile themselves, like they actually like go through the preferences and onboard and do the search and all that. And we're seeing a very high rate, like 85% of those accounts actually become active. and they do the searches, and we've served probably somewhere between maybe 1.2, 1.5 million searches, maybe on top of my head. And so that activity has been like what we focused on from the beginning. And I think one thing that we've started doing it this summer is to also start opening up some of the data. It used to be that you had to come to the airport, you had to sign up to get the data. And now we've created more like public city pages and sub pages where you can get salary data without logging in and all this sort of things. So what we've seen is also a shift of sort of, it's not just the 200,000 people who have accounts, but it's also a bunch of people who find us on Google or point somebody points from forum and are using Teleport in a way that we don't know even who it is really. So they are just consuming data. They are not doing active searching for searches. So roughly we're at about 100,000 monthly actives now. And that is ticking up nicely. So quite happy on that side.
Great. And going back to your days at Skype, you know, customers acquisition, obviously being in the tens of thousands in the early days of Skype and tracking all the people, which obviously is different of a Teleport. How are you using that experience now in Teleport and growing this company?
I think there are many things that are applicable and some things that are not. Out of the things that are applicable, it's always about the people. Like, if you want to build something amazing, you have to have amazing people, because people are the ones building software and services and these things that we do. So I've at Skype especially, I learned to sort of hire people that are smarter than me and sort of let them run loose. So I think we've managed to keep quite a empowering and flat and hierarchy-free culture in Teleport, as well as it was in the early days of Skype, for sure. And people have a lot of liberty to decide and just ship product and test things and fail if they, as you do when you stretch yourself and then fix things and move on. So I think there are elements like that. Then the direct impact is that when you have been through this sort of washing machine or tumbler of a fast growing company, and the relationships you build from there means that probably like half of our team are ex-Skype. You always, when you start something new, you turn to the people that you already know and trust, and some of the, like Jonathan, our DevOps lead, the first employee, he comes from a long time Skype background, and some other people as well. But we also have a good mix of people who have never been to Skype. So it's actually nice to have our own culture and our own little habits and our own little things that we do that we can jointly create. So it's like, I think we also explicitly don't want to be just a little attempt at Skype again. And that sort of the other thing I think you can't borrow. I think one thing that everybody leaving a story like Skype has to readjust. Like when you come from I live in the city of Tallinn right now, which has 400,000 people. And Skype has always been headquartered in Luxembourg, which is like legally headquartered. And it's a country of 400,000 people basically. And so when you live in places like that and you drive to work in the morning and you think that, okay, we added 400,000 users in the last 24 hours. And that's kind of the pace of Skype. And it's so surreal and so much in contrast with what the physical world around you is. It's very easy to get used to it. It's very easy to get used to another 10 million users for granted and things like that. So when you start a new business and startups are hard. I mean, it will take you years to get to any sort of, oh, now we've hit the ramp and things are really moving up and you can sort of ride the wave. And very often the wave doesn't come. So it's I think myself as many other sort of founders who've been to Skype or Facebook or Google or any of this once in a decade big story type of companies, like you have to readjust and feel happy for the next 10 people you can help, and then the next 100, and then the next 1,000, and calibrate again.
Absolutely. And talking about the process of growth, Teleport raised an unusually large seed investment of $2.5 million. How will you make money in the future? Let's talk about money.
Yeah, the seed investment was relatively hefty, and we were lucky that we had investors who trusted us with that. And the premise was that, okay, we're going to go and build something like an early Google. Like, we have to index a lot of information and build consumer traction on that and all that. It will take years. And so we wanted to be in a position where we don't have to over monetize it too early on. I think there are many amazing businesses you can bootstrap. And I always feel in awe to the founders who are building those businesses. But in this particular case, I don't think you can bootstrap a search engine. I don't think you can index the world and sort of build high user activity on a paid product very quickly. So basically that's the story of that funding and the logic of that funding. Obviously, we do have the pressure of proving out business models and figuring out how we eventually make money, and we've been on it. So right now, it seems that the most interesting area for us to go into for early monetization is if on one side we have all this consumer activity and people figuring out where they should live and work, it's always like a dual two-sided market. Like, on one side you have the demand for great places to live in, on the other side you have a supply of amazing cities. And some of those cities we know about, like I don't know, New York and London don't have an issue of people not knowing they can move there. But there are so many great places in the world which don't surface by brand. Like, they have no way to surface by merit, and they're trying to figure out how they can find new citizens, how they can find young people, how they can find new employees for their companies that are growing, how they can find two more English teachers, like this sort of things, or medical nurses or whatnot. And so we've started building out some tools which are about analytics and insights for example, cities to understand how they are performing in searches, where are they winning, are they losing, what's the feedback from people who have lived there, what's their city's NPS score, like very basic things like that. And we're seeing quite a lot of pull, especially sort of tier two, tier three cities, to make more data-based and data-driven decisions and get these sort of insights. So we have a tool we call Teleport Professional, where we are offering them a bunch of dashboards and analytical tools on the either the cost and quality life sets, data sets that we have, or some high level learnings from the searches that users have completed and what the users have done. And the other direction where we've done monetization experiments and we continue doing those is that we want to keep Teleport as free and open as possible as we can, so that more people in the world ask the question, am I at the right place? Should I be moving somewhere? And that should be free. I believe that. But there is this other scenario where people are not doing it for themselves, but they're doing it to other people as a service, like a recruiter helping an incoming candidate. And when those people who use it to power a service of some kind help other people, then we are now testing that maybe there is a special format of the city report that we can generate, and something that they can either buy the reports or subscribe to the data in some way, so to make it really easy for them to support other people on the move. And there are some quite encouraging experiments, especially with like tech company recruitment, but very often happens cross-border. Like, there are needs. I don't know, a candidate is coming from the UK to Finland to work for a gaming company, and then they need to bring their family. And then there's some recruiter who needs to answer all these questions about housing and schools and all these things. So maybe we can help them generate the one-click report on all of these things from Teleport and send it away to the candidate.
We have a question now from someone in the audience. What does the future of Teleport look like over the next 5 years?
So the long-term vision of Teleport is that we want to make every single government in the world to compete for every single citizen. And that is super empowering for everyone involved, because I think competition is inherently a good thing. So you can imagine that if there is any place, and by governments, by the way, we mostly think of cities and urban areas. Like I don't think nation states are as relevant. Like they're not going to go anywhere in 5 or 10 years. But I think it's cities. Like people think about moving to cities. People move to New York or San Francisco or LA, and already that fact tells you so much more than people moving to the United States of America, right? And so when cities are competing for citizens and it's technology enabled, a few things happen. One, if they create a great environment, then people will find out faster than ever before. So if you have great schools, if you have a safe environment, if you have great housing or new developments happening, and people or some amazing companies growing and there are more jobs in your city, people will find out and come. And on the other side, if you screw up an environment, people will leave faster than ever before. So if you raise some tax way too much, or if there's some political gridlock for 2 years, people are going to be hanging around and wasting their lives there. So I think there is that. Then there is another interesting thing that will happen through this competition for citizens is. I think it's going to be a very interesting two-way dialogue between people on the move and the communities. I think there is one thing that is kind of negative or tainted about the image of digital nomads right now, which is that they are kind of like a flock of grasshoppers that go to a place and then they consume all the resources and take what they want and then they move on. And there's like this rootlessness there. But I think the positive future will be much more about how can a community interact with the people who just came in? Or how can, it's not just only about what does the person on the move want, but it's also about what does the community need and want that's already there, and how can they interact and connect? And we're doing quite a bit of effort there. So I hope that in 5 years, we're way further along. Like today, for example, we're running these things called Ask a Local Forums, and we're running a network of teleport scouts, which are both attempts of how can we not just like have the teleport users who are on the move talk to each other and do things and sort of this. We don't want to build a nomad community, but we want to allow people on the move to connect to the local teleport users in those places to get things done and to settle in and to find answers to their questions and things like that. So there is a lot of that as well. And the other thing maybe in 5 year horizon that we are thinking about is that how can we make teleport useful for you so you don't have to go to teleport to search? Like there's so many things where just by your daily actions, so the things that you do, what's a good example is again like a teleport flock scenario. Like if you have people on a teleport sundial and they change location and we know that their location changed, then you should constantly have like maybe teleport flock running in the background that says that, okay, now you have a critical mass of these people one flight away. Maybe you should schedule this thing that you were already planning to now and sort of make these location decisions in a more sort of a backgroundy way. So I'm not sure the teleport needs to be a destination site where you have to always spend time to go there. Maybe we can be smarter about how we can help people. So just a few ideas.
Great. We have another question that's come in. What are some tools that you have found to be helpful when building a remote year, a year away from your home base?
What are the tools that I have used while living away? It's interesting. It's like I have never thought about that in a home and away context. It's kind of like how I think about these things is I manage a portfolio of places where I am at, and it's kind of irrelevant like which of them is like there's less dominance to this sort of places like home and away. There's for example, my last 4 years, for 3 years I was mostly based in California. And then that meant that I spent all the summers in Estonia and elsewhere in Europe. And in between, during the winters, I maybe went every other month across the Atlantic. And now last year, I switched to Tallinn. And my kids go to school here now. And by the way, all this mobility stuff becomes much more fun when you have three kids. And then I now last winter, they went to school here. So that's kind of my more of a base during the school year. But they now went back to the US every other month because I have my friends there, my investors there, like partners. We have still a few employees in California, even though most of them are in Europe. So all of these things like mean that there is no such like clean transition for me anymore. And I think we're hearing from more and more users that that's the case, which, sorry for the long winded answer, but in turn, it means that I don't think there is a tool chain for making for this sort of life when you're away, but there's this tool chain that you live your life with that needs to support that lifestyle. So it's kind of like everything from the sort of the MacBook Pro and the Bluetooth headphones and the calling app that kind of handles your roaming, and maybe there are a few SIM cards that you use around the world, but you kind of retain the contacts somehow. There is this sort of team setup of keeping your code on online repositories and keeping your task list on Asana and keeping your docs on Google Drive as opposed to anybody's hard drive, and all these things that, like, it's not just about myself, but all this, the people I work with at Teleport, that we all sort of adhere, like, keep to those rules, which means that gives us the liberty to move. It's not that there is a separate moving way of living, but that's the way of living.
Another question that's come in, do you think Teleport will ever have, like, will it ever be a job search site? Will it ever have that functionality?
Yeah, we've been thinking about it. What we've done now is the opposite. Like, we let users to sign up and indicate that they want to find a job potentially at that destination. And then we are sort of looking at where interest builds up. And maybe in those cities, we try to find a good source for data for foreigner-friendly jobs. So it's like more user-driven rather than inventory-driven. And the logic there is that that's one of my just crazy, geeky hypotheses that may or may not prove true. But what I believe is that there are like these three corners in a triangle that you can imagine, where in one corner you have the income data, which includes jobs, like how do you make money? In the other corner, you have the cost data, which to a very large part is housing. And in the third corner, you have the logistics corner, the immigration and the visas and the tickets and the boxes and everything related to actually executing a move. And we believe that the move will actually happen when these corners align. There is enough income available at the place where the costs are lower than that income, and you actually have the right passport and the tickets are reasonably priced for you to go. So you need to have this alignment of those corners. And Teleport is smack in the middle of that triangle. So we are trying to help you to make those decisions where the stars align. In order to make the best decisions, it kind of makes sense for us to stay neutral to any of the corners. Like, a $1 billion company can be built in any of those corners, and they are being built. Like the Airbnbs and Zillows cover the housing corner, and then there are this myriad of job sites that cover the jobs corner alone. And then there are all this, I don't know, anything from TripAdvisor to Skyscanner that deals with just the logistics of getting from place to place. And if we shift too far as Teleport, if we shift too far into any of those corners, then I think we actually jeopardize or threaten our core value prop of being sort of neutral and playing nice with all the best sources of data and all that. So that's one of the things why we haven't been, haven't had this sort of urge to build out jobs inventory, for example, because then we become yet another job site for many of our users, plus also reduce the willingness of the best jobs inventory people to work with us with their data, because all of a sudden we're sort of playing in that corner ourselves. So that's why we've been careful, and we'd rather try to find in every country, in every job profession, to find the best source of those ads and send people there.
All right. We have another question coming from the audience. Being part of Skype from the beginning must have been crazy. If you had to pick one, what was the best strategic move you guys made in the early days?
Wow. Ain't that an $8.5 billion question? I think the best strategic move was to solve a few key issues that users actually had with calling over the internet. Like Skype started in 2003. I made my first call over the internet in 93. And I remember two things. Being a relatively technical person, it took me like 40 minutes to configure all the ports and proxies and get online. That was number one. And the number two was that once I was online, there was absolutely nobody to talk to. And the first version of Skype solved those two things out of the box. Like the first version of Skype, no matter how crappy it was compared to like call quality and all the features and videos and all the things that came later, but the first version of Skype allowed you to get online without any configuration and included user search. So if there was some other person on Skype, you could find them. And that means that all of a sudden, like these things that used to be geeky and complex and technical, all of a sudden your grandmother could do it. And that I think is super empowering. And the other, of course, the strategic decision that was done, I don't take credit for any of those decisions because I joined a few months after it was already blowing up, was the choice of architecture, which is, I think that one is interesting to understand, is that the reason why Skype rose so quickly was because of the peer-to-peer architecture Skype used and the smart software engineers that were on the founding team. The marginal cost of adding another million users was near zero. And that's a very luxurious place where you don't have to raise a lot of capital, for example, to add 100 million users, because the users provide their own resources to each other. And that was sort of the winning thing for Skype. But in 2003, it was the winning scenario. In 2013, it was an awful burden, because this peer-to-peer stuff doesn't really work well in the mobile environment. And this entire technology landscape changed very, very quickly. So that's why Skype missed many of the sort of seminal moments of where other players could come in and build new communication software for this new mobile environment. So it's like I'm just highlighting that some of the things that are absolutely the right strategy at that moment in time and make or kill the company, like, in this tech space, like 3 years later, it might be your death sentence.
We have another one from the audience, and I see someone's done their homework. What do you think of Estonia's e-residency program, and do you expect to see similar programs emerging in countries with larger tax bases?
I love the e-residency program. I think it's one of the most forward-looking things happening anywhere in the governments in the world when it comes to sort of how your statehood and relationship to citizens and residents and taxpayers and expanding your economy without immigration and all these sort of very, very strategic questions that every single government should have. I think Estonia is uniquely positioned to start addressing them, but also I think is making some very bold moves there. So there are some very, very smart people there working on this stuff, and I personally cheer for them, and with Teleport we try to build things with them when we can. Definitely other countries will follow. As far as I know, the Netherlands, Finland, Lithuania, I think will have something by the end of the year, they say. Singapore, like several countries are working on similar programs, and they are all active, and I'm sure that that's not the complete list by far, which, like, it's one of those things, like, when you close your eyes and think that what's the natural thing in 50 years, like, will there be only Estonian e-residents? It's absurd. Like, there will be many, and they are competing, and that's good. I think a few comments on these other countries. Like, I think Estonia has the advantage that anything that Estonia is opening up as far as the digital infrastructure has been used inside a country widely or dominantly for 15 years. So many of these other people attempting, like they are trying to create an e-residency-like program from scratch, but it's super expensive and slow. And like I don't know, if you if you already have your entire nation banking using this identity, then adding to a million Estonians banking, adding 10,000 e-residents is a piece of cake. Like, there's no big investments involved. You just expand the system that you have and use the processes that you know that work. If you are starting from zero and you're trying to give 10,000 foreigners access to your tax board and this new technology, and nobody in the country uses it, then it's a way different program. And I think many of the countries trying will have that issue, is that, I don't know, they created this internal digital identity like 5 years ago or 10 years ago. They didn't make it mandatory. Nobody really uses it. And now they try to roll it out broadly. And I don't think it will work too well. And this angle about the larger DAX spaces, I think that's a very, very interesting thing to think about, is that if you noted that all the countries that they listed where I've heard that similar stuff is going on, all of them are like sub 10 million countries. Okay, Netherlands is a bit more, but still, I think there is a huge advantage for countries that are tiny for a few reasons. First, one of them is this ability to make bold decisions and sort of not get drawn into endless conversations about things. And like, parliamentary processes are faster in small countries. And if there's political decision to do something, it might happen faster. Like, Singapore is an amazing example where execution is very, very fast if something is decided. And so that means that for an 80 million person country or a 300 million person country with a huge legacy tax base, legacy system, legacy bureaucracy, it's way harder to actually make those changes happen. So I think they eventually, many of them try, because the small countries are starting to take their business, like, and that will be another fight for who provides the best environment and best value for your tax money. By the way, Estonia doesn't even tax the residents; like, you still pay taxes where you physically are, which is, I think it will take some larger countries a long time to understand how that will even work, but it's fun.
Great. We have another question that's just come in. What types of user research are you doing to figure out what apps or/slash features of Teleport to build next?
Oh, it's a mixed bag. Like, there are some things that we built because we ourselves, living this lifestyle, would like to have them. Very easy way for a startup to do something. If you actually know the problem intimately, what would you need yourself? Like, Sundial is an example. We needed it with our team, and then we put it out there. Then it's always amazing when you can sit down with a user, observe your user using your product, and do this sort of qualitative research and understand what people are doing. Obviously, if you're building a very global product and you're still a small team, it's much harder and usually too expensive to do that at scale. So it's kind of like you occasionally run into somebody who has already use Teleport, and then you try to take most out of that conversation and understand what they like, what they didn't, what they were missing, and do this very personal interviewing. But in most cases, you don't have that luxury. I wish we did that more, but we don't. Like, I keep pushing people to take time off their week and maybe look at the, I don't know, which of the users gave us an NPS score of 10 in the last week, and write them an email and ask for more comments. Like, I don't know. Ask for if they would be willing to schedule a call. And then that leaves you more with the sort of things that you can scale over distance, like running surveys, doing A/B tests, building features, launching them and seeing if they stick or not. So we do all of those things as well. We do less qualitative surveys, maybe. NPS scores are pretty active and we get quite a lot of good comments there. We have tons of feedback buttons around the software that we build, which in some places people use them more than in others. Even though we offer a free product, we try to keep a help desk up. So we have an amazing guy called Jeff, who's a former US ambassador who has made 13 international moves. So he retired as an ambassador, and now he's doing our customer support and user engagement. So if you write to support at Teleport, Jeff will handle your worries and sometimes have very fun conversations with you. So, and from all of those interactions, we try to learn about the product as well. So if anybody complains about anything about your company, then never let them go without understanding, learning something new from them. So.
And do you think that the future of the world is remote work, and will the kind of more traditional model completely disappear?
There are very, very few things in the world that I think are complete or absolute. So it's usually the answers are somewhere in the middle. So I don't think the nation states are going to go away. I don't think everybody is going to move around the planet. Like if you look at the numbers right now, there are about a little over 7 billion people in the world. There are about 3.5 billion jobs in the world. So people are working and getting paid for that. And then no matter how you cut it, like you can look at sort of proxies for remote work done. There is some research that shows that out of the white collar, also the white collar knowledge work jobs, like 20% of them do some way of telecommuting. And I think that's kind of overestimated. That probably includes a lot of corporate people who actually make one conference call a week or something like that. But if 20, like if out of the 3.5 billion jobs, I think 700 million are knowledge work, and then you can proxy some other things out of that and overlay things like, I don't know, surveys of, I think there was a recent European survey where like 64% of people said that when picking up their next job, they are willing to move abroad for that. There are surveys where millennials around the world are saying that 80% of them want to work in another country during their career. But so all this basically scattered data sources, it's usually easier to talk about the numbers with a whiteboard or a slide, but the bottom line is that we estimate right now that about 350 million people have the right skills, the right job type, they work with information rather than things, and they have the right passport and maybe the right languages and all these things to be able to move around. And if it's 350 people, and I think the ballpark is kind of right, then this is still just 5% of the population of the planet. So the question, like, will it grow from there? For sure. like nothing that is powered by exponential change in technology, and the more you have, I don't know, VR-based presence and better remote working tools and sort of easier commute from place to place and mega cities popping up, which are better and better connected with each other, like it will not stay at 5% of the planet will be moving and 95% will be put. Will that flip to the other way, that 5% of the planet will be put and 95% will be constantly moving around and working remotely and all that? Maybe, but I have no clue if the time horizon to that is like 10, 20, 50, 100 years or ever. So I think what is a much more bettable trend is that the optionality of doing remote work and living this sort of more mobile lifestyle will be available for nearly 100% of the Earth's population. But I think from there will be people who will always prefer to build local communities, stay tight. And there are always, like with humans, there are always people who are going to get repressed into a situation where they don't have those choices. Like there is always, unfortunately, going to be some North Korea somewhere, right?
And I know you mentioned before you are aware of Remote Ear, and I know that you've been in touch with Greg, who's one of the founders from the inception. Yeah. What do you think that will be some of the challenges Remote Ear will face going forward?
I think the challenges don't have much to do with the people who decide to join the Remote Ear. Like I think you guys are open-minded, looking for new experiences in your lives, trying to learn more about other cultures, other people, put yourself in new situations and learn about yourself and all these things that sort of make you successful eventually. I think these are all the sort of things that only progress yourselves and humankind, like in broader terms. What the risks and struggles are is to how to make that lifestyle and those things compatible with the rest of the world around you. Like there are still like if you work for a 50,000 person organization and you tell your boss you're going to go and take a remote year, even if they are okay with that, probably there's some tax compliance department somewhere that is going to shoot them. Like, it's like, or even simpler things, their family and friends will probably not understand what you're up to for a while. I think that takes a little bit of, it usually takes a little bit of that phenomena happening when people get used to it. Like, there's no other better way. And I think this, when we talk to HR people and people building larger organizations, I think everybody recognizes that there is this massive millennial new kind of working trend and all this, lots of buzzwords in the air, which they need to deal with at some point. Would it be large corporations? Would it be governments? Would it be tax boards? Would it be, I don't know, visa offices, all these things? But none of them have really figured out what does it actually mean for them. So in that sense, sort of very consistent, well-defined, visible programs like Remote Year actually give many of them this first experience. Okay, there are these people, they want to live this way. Like, how do we have to adopt our ways in order for them to click with that? So I think it's more about relations with the external world rather than the internal problems.
And one last question before we'll wrap this up. Should Remote Year come to Estonia and why?
Absolutely. And it should be in late June, not February, the first trip, I mean. And why would be that there are very few places in the world where you can go to one of the 1,500 islands in the middle of the Baltic Sea, and the sun will go barely down for 1 or 2 hours, but you will still have 50 megabits plus coming from 4G. So you can do all your remote work and have all the local craft beer and sauna while at it. And people usually sleep way less in the summer here because the sun doesn't go down. So it's a fun time. You should check it out.
Well, let's leave with this very positive note. Thank you so much, Sten, for joining us. It's quite late here in Tallinn. And thank you again for doing this and being one of our first in this global speaker series. And thank you, everyone, for joining. Have a good night wherever you are around the world. We'll be sending a recording of this as well, so you can rewatch and to those people who couldn't join us today. So thanks, everyone, and good night.
Cheers. Bye.